Would you dance if I asked you to dance? Would you run and never look back? Would you cry if you saw me crying? And would you save my soul tonight? Would you tremble if I touched your lips? Or would you laugh? Oh, please tell me this. Now would you die for the one you love? Hold me in your arms tonight. I can be your hero, baby. I can kiss away the pain. I will stand by you forever.
My father was born Thomas Edward Franks in Champaign, Illinois, an only child in a prosperous but unassuming family. His father was a morally erect man, and he owned an insurance firm, as well as serving as mayor of the city. His mother was an accomplished pianist, and when she found out her son was tone deaf, she lost interest in him. He seemed not to care. He was too busy teaching himself a multitude of skills. He perfected his marksmanship by shooting woodchucks and squirrels for local farmers. He built a chemistry lab in the cellar and set off explosions in a field on the edge of town until the Champaign police put an end to that. By the time he was 19, he was paying his way through the University of Illinois, majoring in chemistry and engineering. General Alloys, a specialized metal casting firm in Chicago, recognized his gifts and hired him straight out of college. My parents met sometime in 1940 when Tom walked up to the counter at Marshall Fields, where Lorraine, my mom, was selling rare silk stockings. In 1941, my father and my mother married. In 1942, my father fought to fight in the war. He entered the U.S. Navy in late 1942, commissioned as an ensign. Fellow servicemen and friends described my father as a happy, carefree man who loved life. In the beginning, my father was altogether human. In his letters home from the Pacific, he complained about the hard-packed ground on the hills that he ran up and down for training. He carried a lizard named Oscar around on his shoulders, and he wrote impassioned passages to my mother, such as this one. Please write me, my darling, lots of long letters, sweetheart. I miss hearing from you, and you don't know how much. I love you so much, sweetheart, and I can't tell you how much I miss you. I love you, I love you, I love you. And then all that changed.
After the war, my father would go on mysterious business trips. More and more, he would be away from home. He acted with me as he would with adults. Remote, emotionally impenetrable, like someone whose real self has been sucked up into the jaws of a big black hole. Years after my mother died, my father, who was then in his 60s and unemployed, dropped a bomb on me and my sister. He was almost penniless, and we had to sell our beloved family home in Massachusetts. After thinking he was settled, we eventually had to move him again to an even smaller apartment in Milford. He pushed us away from his life with his stubbornness, and I tried to reach some kind of accommodation with him, though every word we shared felt forced. My husband Bob and I invited to our apple orchards in Fishkill, yet my father often canceled at the last minute. The divide between us was too painful. He desperately wanted to see his grandchildren, but he just couldn't face me. I hated being the side of my own mother that he and I both detested. One day, I received a notice from my father's landlord threatening to evict him. His apartment was a fire hazard with boxes everywhere and my father's constant smoking. Out of obligation, I knew I had to take action. I jumped in my car and made for Milford. After searching through many boxes, going through many family memories, I came across a strange box. I fished down to the bottom of the carton, and suddenly I'm holding a military cap with what looks like a crucifix, but it's too square to be a crucifix. I turn the badge over. There's a swastika inside the middle of the cross. An iron cross, a Nazi cap, in my father's house. Discovering them changed everything. I had to find out what this physical evidence meant. I knew my father was fluent in German. He was a crack marksman. He had a demeanor that was absolutely deadpan. He lied, and he knew how to lie. 2 years ago, my husband Bob and I had convinced my father to give a videotaped testimony about his war activities to the Museum of Jewish Heritage. But now I know there is more to his story. It was at this Italian restaurant that the incident happened.
I was in a bar when a man made a very loud, very vicious, terrible anti-Semitic remark. He was only about 6 or 8 feet. I immediately jumped him and took him to the floor with my hands around his throat, and I was trying to kill him. It took 3 men to pull me off. Don't ever judge a person by his ethnic background.
It made me determined to know even more.
The Admiral said, you are going to this group. You are going to Germany to investigate something very unusual that's been uncovered there. Or words like that. And he said, when you get back, I want you to write up a report in longhand for me. And this is something you're not to talk about. The German troops had withdrawn, and we went into this hideous place where there were bodies lying around on the street. We went into another building. There was more bodies stacked up. Then there was evidence of what had been a long bonfire. I had a big library of German books, and after the war I got back, I one by one tore them up and threw them in the trash, and never read any German or anything about them ever since.
I would soon find out that my father, who I thought was a failure all his life, was a man of remarkable bravery. Posed as a Nazi officer, slipping behind enemy lines, reporting on the atrocities he found at one of the first concentration camps. My father revealed to me stray fragments of his secret life over the last several years that he lived. I would have to find the rest of his secrets on my own, from buried paperwork, a bureaucracy designed to maintain secrets, and from the men who served alongside my father, at least the ones who were still alive. I had to weave memory and history into a full human portrait of a complicated soul. I never knew him. He was a spy. He was a hero. He was an everyday man. My father. And I never knew how much he truly loved me.